Good evening, good evening, good evening. Blessings and peace to one and all. I hope everybody's having a wonderful evening. Got a little MJ in the background right now. Heal the world. Let me get some folks tagged up while the music's playing. Because them, you can't miss these lyrics. These lyrics we got to have and we got to hold on to, especially in the troubling times we're in right now. So let me get some folks tagged up right quick. Heal the world. Make it a better place. For you and for me and for the entire human race. You know we can do that. We can do it. Make a better place for you and for me. Come on, Mike. Come on, Mike. Dropping that knowledge. Make a better world. Yes, we can. But when I hear songs like that, I just automatically think about certain people, you know. One couple that comes to mind is, Barack and Michelle Obama. For sure. And there's so many people that's out here right now striving to make this world a better place. Right here in the low country. Boots on the ground. I'm tagging up a bunch of them right now. For sure. Come on, Mike. Preach that message. You are all my brother. No fear, together we'll cry happy tears. The nations turn their swords into plowshares. I'm gonna turn their swords into plowshares. Make a little space. Make a better place. Heal the world. For you and for me and for the entire human race. There are people dying. If you care enough for the living, if you just care, make a better place for you and for me. Come on, somebody. Come on, somebody. My brother, I just tagged. Please forgive me. Please untag yourself if you don't want to be involved in this, for sure. You know, I definitely won't be offended, and please don't be offended that I tagged you. Heal the world. Well, I'm tagging a whole bunch of folks shouldn't have been tagged tonight. My apologies. It'll be all right. Make a better place for you and for me. Folks, that's our job. That's the mission that's been set before us. But unfortunately, we've been failing in that mission. And it's time for us to change that. It's time for us to change that. Come on, Mike. Mm. save it for our children. We ain't doing that. And we can do it. That's the charge that we have, is to save the world, make it a better place for everyone. Good evening, good evening, good evening. It's the pastor here. Deborah, how are you? Chef, what's going on? Good to see you, my brother. Good evening. Miss B, good evening. How are you? Deborah, good evening. The humble singer C in the house, what's going on? LT, what's going on, LT? All right, doing okay. Good to see you. Latoya, praying that you're well. Okay, I know that you've had a mishap recently. I'm just praying that you're on the rebound right now. Carolyn, good to see you. All right. Always a pleasure and an honor to have you in the house. That's for sure. Yeah. Miss B, all right. Kim, yes, yes, the whole household. Yes, Brother John, what's going on? I'm good. I'm good. I'm blessed in the Lord. You know, I'm weary, but you know, it's that wind that's beneath the wings, and that wind comes from good people like yourself and others who tune in. You could be anywhere else right now, but you tune in right now to hear a little something, you know, about the state of the nation that we're in and how we can do what Mike just said, make this world a better place for everyone. Gina, that's right, for a better place. Good to see you, Gina. All right, Yvette, how are you? Yes, good to see you. All righty, all righty. Oh, man, Mo better on here. My brother Mike better. His Mo better. Patrina, how you doing? Good to see you. Good to see you. Much love to you and the family. Jason, what's happening, brother? Yes, sir. Yes, sir. Good to see you. Elizabeth, what's going on? All right, Jamie, what's happening? Yeah, for sure. That's the charge that we have, you know, really. And we have neglected that charge for a long time. We have sort of half-heartedly allowed the world around us to implode on us. We haven't done our due diligence when it comes to our elected officials, which is the subject of what I'm talking about tonight. And in particular, because our elected officials are the ones who really are in charge of governing our day-to-day lives. They're the ones that enact legislation, that vote on legislation. They're the ones who are supposed to be representing the voice of the people. They're the ones who the people actually select, no matter what party they represent. The people select these elected officials to represent them. Evangelist Michelle Felder, what's going on? As we say, peace, for sure. We, the people of the United States, our charge is to elect people who we first off believe in, that will take care of our best interests and represent us and be a voice for the people. But much times, Taisha, what's going on? Jamil, what's happening, brother? Sid, what's going on? Sydney, what's going on? All right. Much times, many times, and it's been this way for a few decades, we've gone to the polls. Yes, we've shown up at the polls. Sometimes we haven't shown up at the polls. Let me just be honest about that. We've been a little slack on our showing up at the polls at times. But we've gone to the polls and we voted for people. And that's been what we thought was the end of our responsibility. We cast a ballot because we believe in these folks and they just go and do what they're supposed to do. My friends, that ain't working. That has not worked for a long time, and that's why we're in the condition we're in right now. No longer can we just send elected officials off to wherever, inside of our city council or county council or mayor's offices, inside of our sheriff's offices and our solicitor's office and our coroner's offices, inside of our school districts and our state house, inside of Congress and even the White House. We can't just send people off and think they're going to do right because we tried that. And guess what, folks? It ain't work. It ain't work. I know that's bad English, but y'all correct me later. It'd be all right. Y'all be all right. I know it. I know where the English police at. I know y'all out there. So that's kind of where I'm going tonight, is to talk about the elections. But before I go there, I would be remiss in my duties as a community representative if I didn't stop and say something about the insanity that's happened in Lafayette, Louisiana last Friday, and then again in Kenosha, Wisconsin on Sunday. I'm supposed to say something, but I can't find the words. Because for far too long have I had to give this message. Sandino, what's going on? Christopher, what's happening, brother? Alrighty. For far too long, I've had to talk about people who have died because of over-aggressive policing. Okay? Now, for those of you who know me, you know that I'm not stuck on, when it comes to gun violence, over-aggressive policing, because that is gun violence. You know that the overall, the far-reaching arc that of my moral advocacy extends beyond just law enforcement shootings to hood shootings and shootings involved in domestic violence and just people getting hurt out here. No mass shootings, all of it. That's what I deal with. That's why tonight I chose to wear my Brady campaign shirt. I don't know if you all realize it, but I am Brady. I am Brady. I sit on the Brady campaign to prevent gun violence, which is now just Brady United or just Brady. They're National Board of Trustees. The work that I've tried to do to end gun violence that just hasn't happened or hasn't worked thus far, probably because I don't get any cooperation or asked to even sit at the table here locally. Scripture says that a prophet is without honor in his own homeland. That's the first place. No respect in their own homeland. I can get respect in Washington, D.C. and nationally as being a board member for the Brady campaign. But when it comes time to try to end gun violence in the low country, they go look for everybody else but Pastor Dixon. They'll be all right. Maybe one day. Maybe when that last person that they're really fed up about dying because of gun violence happens, maybe we ought to give Pastor Dixon a call. After all, he have been shot at out here and survived and not in no wartime situations. After all, he did grow up in the projects. After all, he been a part of that life, been about that life for about 30 years and been to prison too. Maybe he might know a little something. Oh, and then the Brady campaign did seek him out to make them a board member on their National Board of Trustees. Maybe he does know a little something. Yep, for sure. Dropping it. Julius, what's happening, brother? How you doing, brother? Good to see you. Good to see you. Thank you for all that you do. Sandino in the house. What's up? But I would be remiss in my duties, okay, if I didn't take a minute, because I'm skipping over COVID tonight. I talked about COVID last night, and there have been 7 more deaths, or so they say, in South Carolina today. But I want to get into what we really need to talk about. But like I said, I'd be remiss in my duties, especially as I'm talking about and wearing the Brady logo today, which on the back it says, take action, not sides. I ain't gonna turn all the way around, but it says, take action, not sides, because when it comes to common sense gun legislation, there seems to be a battle. One side battling against the other one while people are dying, which makes no sense to me. So Brady's slogan is, take action, not sides. Let's get this legislation passed, because not passing legislation has led to people dying, including in officer-involved shootings. So Friday, we had the officer-involved shooting in Lafayette, Louisiana, of a 30-year-old man. His name is Trayford Pellerin. Trayford Pellerin. And Mr. Pellerin made the tragic mistake of bringing a knife to a gunfight with the police. Not a wise move. Here in North Charleston in 2003, we had a man by the name of a mentally challenged man by the name of Asbury Wilder, right on Rivers Avenue. He brought a knife to a gunfight with the police, and he died right there. You know, same thing in Chicago. I think maybe 3 or 4 years ago, they had, I think it was a 19-year-old. His name was Laquan McDonald. He brought a knife to a gunfight with the police. And he was shot 16 times and died in the street that night. Officer just unloaded on him. So on Friday, in Lafayette, Louisiana, Trayford Pellerin, 31 years old, African-American, with a knife, walking away from law enforcement, hit with the tasers. Apparently, the tasers didn't stop him. So I guess the popo said, well, we're going to stop him one way or another. And they unloaded on him. It was more than 10 shots fired into that young man. They killed him. Another one. And dying, it's no different if there's a knee on the neck by a gunshot or a rope over a limb. It's still the same thing. So that was Friday. Black Lives Matter. Maybe from Friday until Sunday, Black Lives Mattered. But on Sunday in Kenosha, Wisconsin, I'm sure you've all seen the video. 21-year-old Jacob Blake he actually broke up a fight, and the police were called. And the police came after him, and they followed him around his car, and he opened up the door, and one officer grabbed him by his shirt like to bring him back out of the car. And instead of tasing him, he pulled his service revolver and squeezed off 7 shots in Mr. Blake's back. Who does that, man? Who does that? 7 shots in his back. Mr. Blake lived. I don't know how, only but for the grace of God, by miracle. That's all that I can see. Sasha, how you doing? Lawson, how you doing? That's all. Just by a miracle, he lived. But the question, though, I would have to ask in that situation, yes, he lived, but what kind of quality of life is he going to have? When I looked at the slow motion of the video, right, this guy was shooting literally at the middle, lower middle of his back. Now, I'm not a medical doctor. I'm not a coroner. I'm not anybody that's qualified to make any kind of medical judgments. But from my untrained eye, looking at where he fired 7 shots at, that man's spine might be a little messed up. So though he survived this attack, what quality of life is he going to have from now on? And did you know, I know they didn't, at first they didn't report it too much, but his kids were sitting in the car 2 feet away when they saw their father get shot by the police. Every few days, there's a new name. Every few days, there's a George Floyd or a Breonna Taylor. Every few days, there's a Trayvon Martin or an Emmett Till. Every few days, there's an Ahmaud Arbery or Sandra Bland. Every few days, there's a Eric Garner or Mike Brown or Philando Castillo or a black man somewhere that's being shot, unarmed black man, by the police. And bringing a knife to a gunfight does not qualify for a pass. A person got a knife, you got a gun. You got a taser, you got mace, you got 20 more cops around. And you got to put your knee on our neck or 7 bullets in our back for you to feel like you're some kind of a man or authority figure or something. It's crazy. I don't want to get stuck there. I will. And remember, nobody has been arrested in this Breonna Taylor case yet. But they talk about swift justice. In the Laquan McDonald case in Chicago, because nobody was there. Thank God for these different cases that we've seen recently, folks with their cell phones out, right, taking the videos. Thank God we have video representation from the community now. Folks Facebook Live and everything, because when Laquan got McDonald was killed by the police, 16 shots. There were no civilian cameras. There was only police body cam. And they didn't release that body cam footage for almost 2 years. So the police, the officer, I hate to even call him an officer, the animal that shot Laquan McDonald, walked around and had him a good time and went and ate and partied and celebrated holidays and all of that for 2 years before they even released the video. And the community said, man, are you crazy? Why arrest this fool? And everybody else who covered it up should have been arrested. Let me get off my rant, okay? But I know I could stay there. But that's why I wore Brady tonight. I want folks to understand. Ending gun violence has always been my passion. Always been. Because growing up in the projects, I've been around it. Like I said, I've been shot at in the projects. They missed, thank God. I've got friends that they didn't miss. Some that were hit various different methods and ways, and they had to live with that for the rest of their lives. But it's been my passion to end gun violence in all aspects, and I don't care what aspect it is. It could be officer-involved shootings, Ray Ray and Pookie and them in the hood shooting each other, a white person that shoots a black person that shoots a white person, a civilian that shoots a cop, domestic violence shootings. It doesn't make me a difference what the circumstances are. I'm trying to end gun violence and the broken hearts that are associated with it. So that's enough on there. Okay, I'm about to break myself down on here. Okay, y'all got to forgive me. Y'all got to forgive me. Okay. Let me see. Did I catch up? I think I caught up. I think I caught up. Okay, yeah, I did. Great, great. Okay. 2020 elections. Okay, I'm going to do tonight and tomorrow night. And I think either next week or maybe even the end of this week, I'm going to do two more sessions. Okay. Tonight is going to deal with the federal elections. Okay, the presidential election and also our congressional elections. Okay, tomorrow night I'm dealing with our state elections. Okay, most primarily they will be for our area because it's just too big for me to cover the whole state, but primarily for the races in our area, I'll be dealing with on the state level for the South Carolina House of Representatives and the South Carolina Senate. Okay. And then later on this week, I'm going to do, or early next week, because I got a lot going on, especially in the aftermath of what these things that happened yesterday and Friday. But the next one after the state elections will be our elections on the local level. And local by local, I mean our county elections, okay? Solicitor's office, sheriff's office, coroner's office, our county council races, and things of that sort. I'm going to do everybody on that third live, except for the school board. The school board is going to have a special Facebook Live with the pastor because there are some things that I want you to hear, and I want you to invite people in so that you understand that we cannot allow special interest groups to buy elections or take control of the best interests of our children, because the reality of it is that they're buying these elections is not going to bode well for our children. And when I talk about our children, I mean black, brown, and poor children. Let me be specific. Okay, so that's going to be a special one. I'm going to talk about candidates who I support, those that I don't support, and why. The school board, as it is already seated, the current superintendent, And I want you all to understand something that I think you all know about me. I'm not in this to win friends and influence people. I'm in here to tell the truth so that truth can set us free. We are not going to allow our children to be sold off into the incarcerated world of slavery. We're not going to allow them to be mediocre applicants in a world where competition is based on education. We're not going to accept second-rate representation within the school board and the school district any longer. I don't care how much money these people got. We're going to get them the heck out of here. Be advised. And any politician, be it elected or incumbent, who wants to side with these people, you've already placed yourself on the other side of Pastor Dixon. I love you, and there's absolutely nothing you can do about it. But when I tell you the truth about merchandising our children out of here, don't get mad. Quit doing it. Quality public education, period. There is no other option. Stop selling our kids out. Okay? And that goes for anybody and everybody. I know don't too many politicians watch my lives, and that's for sure. But you can show enough share this thing out. Because I can't. I'm not going to edit it. I can't edit it. I say what I say, and I mean what I say. And I'm not trying to, like I said, win friends and influence people. I don't do this for no likes or nothing like that. Y'all don't have to like nothing. That y'all don't hit them buttons here, okay, at all. I'm good with that. It's about sharing information that's going to help our community. And that's all I'm interested in, period. So tonight, the 2020 elections, let me get into this thing. 2020, at the top, from the top down, who's at the top? Anybody out there know? Who are the presidential candidates? Well, I know there are two incumbents, or those who are already in office that are running again. But for me, when I talk about presidential candidates, I talk about people who are presidential candidates. And the two that's already in office ain't neither one of them presidential. Mm-mm, not at all. Donald Trump, I'm going to say the name tonight. I don't like to even say the name. Donald Trump, mm-mm. DJ T-Rump, sometime I call him, okay? Because his first name is Donald, middle initial J. Trump, DJ T. Rump, Rump in capital letters, and his cohort, Mike Pence. Or if you are the actress, what's her name? Julia Dreyfus from the Democratic, the last night of the Democratic National Convention, Mike Pence. Or as I like to call him, I say 2 pence, 4 pence, 6 pence. Okay. Whatever pence he is, I don't care. I really don't care. I do know one thing. They need to go. Okay. They are on the ballot. There are no other Republicans on the ballot. And the only other people that are running for the president, the presidential election, the two that are actually presidential candidates, not like them other two. You have Joe Biden and former Vice President Joe Biden and Senator Kamala Harris. And I'm rocking with them. I'm rocking with them even though Joe's 77. Former Vice President, 2-term under former President Barack Obama, 77 years old, that made all kind of mistakes in his life and his career. But guess what? I can't point a finger at him because I done made 1,000 mistakes myself. For sure. But what I can do is I can stack him up against Donald Trump. And I know deep down in my heart of hearts, that Joe Biden has more of my interest at heart than Donald Trump ever will. Ever will. Okay? Ever will. This is the reality of it. So I'm not going to deal. As a matter of fact, Donald Trump is 74. Okay, so Joe is 77. Trump is 74. Mike Pence is 61. And Kamala Harris is the youngest of the four at 55 years old. Wow. So we got the oldest one that's running and the youngest one that's running is Democrats. I'm kind of good with that. Because, you know, if the old one don't make it, right, if we win, once we win, if God forbid anything happened, but if Joe just happens to, you know, not make it all the way, guess who becomes the president? This 55-year-old mixed race African-American woman. Wow. So I'm not here to really talk about Joe tonight. And I'm definitely not here to talk about DJ T. Rump or 2 pence, 4 pence, 6 pence, 1 punce. But I definitely want to talk about Kamala Harris. For sure. I definitely want to talk about her. Because there's so much controversy and people, I don't understand, folks. When you look at 3.5 years of Donald Trump and you know it's re-election time and there's only those two, him and Punce, and Joe Biden and Kamala Harris, those are the only ones that are on the docket. Those are the only choices you got. And you got people sitting here talking, well, I got to think about this or whatever. And you know that Joe did this and Kamala did that and all this. And then it's those that just say, no, not Kamala. And then they talk about, I'm keeping it real. You ain't keeping it real. What you're doing is you acting on your emotions and your emotions are deceiving you. Because keeping it real means looking honestly at Donald Trump, a white supremacist, okay? I'm going to talk to people of color on that one. A white supremacist who's trying to make America great again by returning us to the cotton fields. And you got to figure something out. You're trying to keep it real. Keeping it real is I'm not going to support MASA over an extremely qualified African-American candidate. As a matter of fact, I'm not going to support no white supremacist over any. It could be a donkey running for this office, a jackass. And I'll vote that four-legged jackass in the office quick as I can to get rid of Donald Trump and Mike Pence. Straight up. I'm sorry, biracial, okay? Kamala, let's figure it out, okay? There are those who say she locked up black men, okay? Kamala didn't lock up black men. She was a prosecutor in a racist criminal justice system. The criminal justice system that targeted black men. It's the system, okay? There's a difference. She did her job, and she's no more culpable for incarcerating black men than every single employee in the criminal justice system. We don't say the clerk of courts down at the office did all of this here. Clerk of court get invited to the Christmas party. Crickets on her seeing the problem and starting racial bias training. She saw the problem. She started racial bias training. And she started the pretrial intervention programs. And the Back on Track recidivism programs, now touted as the Justice Department. Yeah, she started those. Okay. Those who say that she's not qualified. Well, Kamala Harris is more qualified to be VP than President Obama was to be president when he ran. And more qualified than both current occupants of the White House right now. Yes, she's qualified. For sure. They say that they only picked her because she's a black woman and they are pandering. That's them folks keeping it real, folks. Well, congratulations. That's called influence. Regardless of what it was, it's called influence. Get used to being considered that if you ever want true representation. Who do you think they've been pandering to for the last 244 years? It ain't been us and it ain't been women. So ain't it about time to get some pandering done to the black woman? Well, those same real people, they say that she's not black enough. She's not black enough. I've heard these people say this craziness. Well, check this out, okay? She's blacker than the last 45 vice presidents and 44 out of the 45 last presidents that we've had. Also, I'm still waiting for my copy of the How to Be Black and Influence People manual that everybody seems to have received at birth, but me, I ain't get that. She blacker than 45 previous vice presidents and 44 out of the 45 presidents that we had. So come on, somebody. You want to dog out the sister, huh? Those folks say her politics don't align with mine. Yet they found a way to vote for prior candidates whose politics obliterated our community. If you believe in democracy, her politics are more closely aligned to yours than 45's. When I say 45, I mean DJ T-Rump. That's right. How black do you have to be? What is black enough? I love it. I love it. The comments. Pander to reality. That's right. That's right. There are those that say this has nothing to do with her being a woman. She's just not the right woman for the job. The right woman for the job is the woman who's qualified, available, and chosen for the job. That's the right woman. Also, not acknowledging her gender is akin to saying, I don't see color. It's dismissive and it's disrespectful. Those same keep it real people, they say, I just don't like her. You don't like her? This ain't grade school. It's not a popularity contest. This is a matter of Biden-Harris or Trump-Pence. Whether you like her or not, what are you going to do? Allow the white supremacists to get back in office again? I can't imagine what's going to happen to America with four more years under this fool. And we got an opportunity to elect Joe Biden, whose values, mistakes, yes, who hasn't? But his value system is a good value system. And if you look at the platforms that he's already put together and the programs he's prepared to implement. These are some amazing looks at today's society to make the playing field level for everyone. It's amazing. And then he's got Kamala Harris as his vice president, pushing him, urging him, guiding him, nudging him in the direction, working toward a nation with liberty and justice for all. I just don't like her. Grow up. Then they say that, well, she attacked Joe Biden during the debates, and now they're friends. Well, maybe not the best strategy, maybe human error. But they're adults. Talk it out, move on, and the heck with the grudges. Let's get this job done. Looks like they came to that conclusion. There are those who want to talk about age, okay, who say that no one above the age of 21 is morally fit to run for office. If you lived in the U.S., you've propped up institutions that are not in your best interest on countless occasions, okay? In other words, no one is in a position to judge moral aptitude. We can't just discount folks, especially in this race, looking at who the other side is. We cannot do that. Okay. She doesn't inspire me. This is something they say. She doesn't inspire me. The question we'd always ask, are you voting for a motivational speaker or a part of a team to normalize our current conditions and to make America an America that serves everybody? If you want a motivational speaker, go see T.D. Jakes. If you want somebody to run our country and make it right for everybody, vote Biden-Harris 2020. Keeping it real is not a skill, okay? It just means you're easily susceptible to your own emotions, and now is not the time to deal with elections on an emotional basis. Now is the time to look at the reality of the situation that we sit in. in America today, with a president in office who ignored the warning signs about a pandemic coming this way, and because of his lack of understanding, his refusal to even read and act, we have 175,000 dead in the United States. They could have been lessened if he just would have not made it about him. The Democrats, it's a hoax. They're trying to steal the election from me. Let's open up right now, because if we stay closed up, people might vote against me. People are dying because of the same fool, okay? For sure. Everyone's so eager to tell the world how they feel, but this is not a feelings competition, folks. Let's just get that straight. This is politics, and this is for life. So when it comes to Kamala, as I finish this segment and move on to our congressional area, on the female side of it, yes, all of the women on here, I support you 100%. I'm not into that male chauvinism. I'm thoroughly good with my maleness, for sure. I'm not insecure in it, and I'm going to promote qualified females every chance that I get, for sure. So on the female side of it, until there's equal representation, there hasn't been that. In spaces and places of influence, we don't have the luxury of getting in our feelings, getting caught up in our emotions. We don't have the luxury of favoritism, sexism, ageism, or racism. Yes, Kamala Harris is an AKA. Kamala Harris is biracial. Kamala Harris is light-skinned. Kamala Harris is married to a white man. Yes, she was a prosecutor. Yes, she was an attorney general. Yes, she did incarcerate black people as part of their sentencing. And yes, she did let Joe have it before the primary. Yes, she did attend an HBCU. Yes, she ran for the president of the United States. Yes, she is a senator. Yes, she is a trailblazer. Yes, she is highly qualified. And yes, she is proof that we can. And yes, she stands on the shoulders of such great people like Fannie Lou Hamer, Shirley Chisholm, Barbara Jordan, and Dorothy Height. And yes, she even has the propensity to actually become president. And she needs the support of all of us. Her along with her running mate, Kamala Harris's running mate, Joe Biden. And yes, she represents the dismantling of centuries of sexism, misogyny, racism, and inequalities against black women that have organized, supported, led, raised, worked, studied, planned, created, cooked, cleaned, called, waited, helped, hurt, cried, fought, moaned, counseled, defended, sang, prayed, and held it together for everybody. Great women. Great women. She is a woman, a black woman that needs our support. That same support that we all seek but don't often find it, because why we shouldn't people are considered long before the why we shoulds. Those naysayers. Put them on the back burner. Ain't nobody got time for that. Joe Biden and Kamala Harris 2020. I'm riding with Biden and Kamala. I don't know about you, but I'm going to tell you straight up, I'm going to do everything that I can to make sure that we get rid of the current occupants of the White House and turn the White House into the people's house with Kamala Harris and Joe Biden. Okay? Yep. They're not perfect. No, they're not perfect. But they're the only Democratic candidates on the ticket. They're the only other candidates other than Trump and Pence on the ticket. It's either them or it's Trump-Pence, period. There are no other options. So please remember these facts, okay? You're not just voting for president. You're voting for who's going to replace Ruth Bader Ginsburg on the Supreme Court. You're voting for the next Secretary of Education and getting rid of the Betsy DeVos and the privatization of our students. You're voting for federal judges and you're voting for the rule of law. You're voting to save our national parks and for letting kids out of cages. Remember, this is all in this election. You're voting for clean air and clean water. You're voting for sensible gun laws. You're voting for scientists to be allowed to speak about climate change and for rebuilding the CDC. You're voting for housing rights. You're voting for LGBTQ people to be treated with dignity. You're voting for dreamers, the DACA dreamers. You're voting so that there will be Social Security and Medicare when you retire. You're voting for veterans to get the care that they desire, and you're voting for rural hospitals and health care for all. You're voting for the preservation of the public broadcast system, and now it looks like the preservation of the Postal Service. And you're voting to have a president who doesn't embarrass this country every time he or she attends an international meeting. And you're voting also against allowing our nation, the United States of America, against allowing it to become yet another authoritarian regime under the absolute dictatorship of Donald Trump, a person that I personally believe is insane in so many different levels. Now, I know there are people that are going to tell me you're supposed to respect the president. Well, I never said those words about Barack Obama or any other president before him. I'm going to call it just as it is. Donald Trump is out of his darn mind and he needs to be removed. Period. You and I have the ability to do that in November with this election. Okay? Remember, no Democrat is perfect. So let's not worry about perfection right now. As a matter of fact, nobody that goes to the polls to vote is perfect. So let's not set the standard for our candidate for the president higher than we can even live up to. No candidate will pass your personal purity test. But if you stack any imperfect Democrat up against 4 more years of Trump, I'm going to drop it and leave it right there. Okay. So the reality is I'm really hoping, though, that as we're moving forward, that all of those folks, you know, we had about 100 people that was running for president, Democrats running for president of the United States, right? It was at least 100 of them, I think. But all of those names that ran before, I'm looking forward. I've seen some of them out there already, but I'm looking forward to seeing them making calls. It's sort of hard in COVID to knock on doors, to be sending out messages and everything about getting behind Joe Biden. I'm waiting to see them. Michael Bennett, Bill de Blasio, Cory Booker, Steve Bullock, Pete Buttigieg, Julian Castro, John Delaney, Tulsi Gabbard, Amy Klobuchar, Wayne Messam, Beto O'Rourke, Tim Bryan, Bernie Sanders, Joe Sestak, Tom Steyer, Elizabeth Warren, Marianne Williamson, and Andrew Yang. I've seen some of them out there already pushing for Joe Biden, but I haven't seen all of them. I'm waiting to see all of them because it is that crucial. We as Democrats need to come together and unite to make sure that Biden-Harris wins this election. They need to be the next president and vice president of the United States in 2020 and again in 2024 for the second term. Y'all hear me? It's now or it's destruction. That's it. The bottom line, okay? Yeah, he's crazy, Deborah, for sure. He's dangerous, Christopher, for sure. That's it. Okay, so South Carolina elections. The United States elections. The federal elections, okay? So federal elections, we have, first off, the highest level of election is with the president. and the vice president. And then right up under that are the elections for Congress, okay? Congress is made up of two houses. The lower house is the House of Representatives, and the upper house is the Senate. Those in the lower house, in the House of Representatives, are elected for, for 2 years, while those who are elected to the United States Senate are elected for 6 years, okay? Each state has two United States senators. Okay. Our United States senators here in South Carolina, I'm sure you will recognize their names and their party affiliation. They're both Republicans, and one is Tim Scott, who I ran against in 2016, and the other is Lindsey Graham, who's up for election right now. Lindsey's been in office 17 years. He was elected in 2003. And the reality is, I'm just going to cut it like it is, he's about worthless now. There was a time when he kind of seemed like he had some kind of care and concern for the community. It seemed like that, at least. But since since being enamored by Donald Trump, he done went crazy. Lindsey Graham done went just buck crazy. One moment he said that Donald Trump was crazy, and the next moment he says he's perfectly sane. Lindsey done lost his mind. But after 17 years of Lindsey Graham voting against everything from everything, anything that Barack Obama put out, voted against it, anything, voting strictly along party lines, Republican Party lines, no kind of consideration for the people, not when it comes to gun violence, not when it comes to health care, not when it comes to education, not when it comes to our environment, not when it comes to anything, voting straight party lines, siding with Mitch McConnell and them, okay, them folk. It's time for Lindsey to go. It's time for him to go. And this year we have a young man from South Carolina running against him. It's an Orangeburg native, former chair of the South Carolina Democratic Party, and somebody who I first actually met when I ran for U.S. Senate. And it wasn't the best start off, but he's my friend now. And he's the one who needs to replace Lindsey Graham. And his name is Jamie Harrison. Jamie Harrison's on the ticket right now, okay? So let me just say this, okay? If you decide that you don't want to vote for Trump, if you decide that you don't want to vote for Biden Harris and Kamala Harris, and you say, well, I'm not going to go vote, period, because neither of them. If you do that, then you're not casting a vote for Jamie Harrison to get rid of Lindsey Graham. What? It doesn't make sense. When you go vote, you're voting for not only the president, but you're voting for those that's up under there, too. And we have an opportunity to vote for every Democrat down from the president right on down to our county school board. Come on, folks. We got to get to the polls and we got to vote. But Jamie Harrison is the Democratic candidate running against Lindsey Graham. There's one more candidate in that race. He's the Constitution Party candidate. His name is Bill Bledsoe. I think Bill Bledsoe runs every time that there's an election because he ran against me too. And I beat him, okay? Yes, Tim Scott beat me, but I beat him. So, you know, I guess he got money like that. I don't know. But we need to make sure we get behind Jamie because Lindsey Graham got to go. I can't say that Tim Scott's going to go now because Tim will be in there until 2022, I believe it is. Yeah, until 2022. Yeah, actually inauguration 23. But that's when it's time for him to go too. So we need to be looking for a candidate to vet to run against him and win. Okay? So that's on the Senate side because we only have two U.S. senators in Congress. Right now, it's Lindsey Graham and Tim Scott. And I pray that after November the 3rd, it will be Tim Scott and Jamie Harrison, directly up under President Joe Biden and Vice President Kamala Harris. Yes, 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 I can drop that one. I'll smile on that one for sure. But then we look at the House of Representatives, okay, as I get near to a close. In the House of Representatives, in South Carolina is divided up into seven House districts, okay? So we have seven representatives from South Carolina in the House of Representatives, in the lower chamber of Congress. Remember, Congress is two chambers. It's the House and the Senate. And the House is the upper chamber. The House is the lower chamber and the Senate is the upper chamber. Senators are elected for 6 years. House members are elected for 2 years. In District 1, in the seven districts in South Carolina, District 1, our current representative is Congressman Joe Cunningham. Congressman Cunningham won in 2018, taking over and helping to flip the House. The House, as a matter of fact, let me just back up. The Senate is predominantly Republicans, okay? And they're the final say-so when it comes to passing legislation. Legislation goes from the House to the Senate. They can pass in the House, go to the Senate, and get stalled out. And that's really what happens to good bills that will help people. Because the House, after Joe Cunningham and a couple more won in 2018, we flipped it from being Republican control to Democratic control. So now in the House, we are getting bills going through the House to the Senate that will benefit the people that are getting into the Senate and getting stopped because the Senate is full of Republicans. We got to flip the U.S. Senate this year, okay, and maintain the House as a Democratic House. And Joe Cunningham is running again, and he's running against a Republican candidate named Nancy Mace. Y'all might know her from her Citadel experience or something like that. And somebody said, if you can't say something good about somebody, don't say nothing at all. And I kind of violated that rule already most of the evening. So Nancy Mace, please elect Joe Cunningham, please, because she ain't right. She ain't right at all, okay? She ain't right. I don't know where her hood at. I'm going to leave that alone, okay, right now. But Joe Cunningham, tell you what, you know, I'm with Brady, right? The Brady bill was passed in 1996. And in 25 years, there's been no legislation passed in the House to change any gun laws or to implement any gun laws, to make our nation safer. Why? Because the Republicans have had control of the House. When Joe Cunningham won in 2018, he partnered up with Congressman Jim Clyburn, and for the first time, they passed common sense gun legislation in the House since the Brady bill was passed. 25 years. The first time. See, that's what happens when you take control. Unfortunately, we don't control the Senate. So when it went from the House into the Senate, guess where it's been all this time since they passed it? Sitting on Mitch McConnell's desk and is not going to pass there because he's not going to do anything with it. Why? Because he gets paid by the NRA. Don't care nothing about saving lives. Nothing whatsoever. So in the first congressional district, which is the district I live in right here, Joe Cunningham is the incumbent running, and he's running against Nancy Mace. We got to make sure that Joe gets reelected, okay? We must make sure of that. In the second congressional district, okay, right now, there's a Republican that sits in that seat. His name is Joe Wilson. He's been there since 2001, 19 years. Y'all might remember Joe Wilson, I think, from the Obama administration. You remember Obama had this, was giving a speech, right, in the House, right? And there was a yell from the crowd, "You lie," loud as he wanted to, just totally disrespectful of the president. That was Joe Wilson. That's our South Carolina second congressional district congressman, Joe Wilson, Republican, who votes against everything that's good for the people and for everything that's not, because he's a Republican, period. Been there 19 years since 2001. Joe got to go. We got a female Democrat running against him named Adair Ford Burroughs. Adair is the one. She's the truth. She believes in all the values that I believe in. And we need to make sure that she gets into office in the 2nd Congressional District. In the 3rd Congressional District, you got another Republican. You see, Republicans been running South Carolina. That's why we stay last in everything we should be first in, and first in everything we should be last in. They run it at the congressional level and at the state level. I'm going to talk about that tomorrow, how they running at the state level. Because until we flip that, we're not going to see liberty and justice for all in South Carolina. Republicans got to go, period. They got to go. They in this for themselves. 3rd Congressional District. The Republican who's in office right now, the congressman, is Jeff Duncan. Jeff Duncan been there for 9 years. 2011, he was elected. Jeff Duncan got to go, and he's running against my friend, Hosea Cleveland. Hosea ran for that seat in 2016. And in 2018, Mary Guerin ran for it, okay? Now's the time to upset Jeff Duncan. Jeff Duncan is one of those for show good old boys, okay? That area that they live in, that he lives in, that area that Hosea lives in, it's a very red area. But we can flip that this year. We can flip that. Because there's a whole lot of people out here, even Republicans, who don't like Donald Trump. Why? Because he's crazy. They know he's crazy. And they know that our nation is never going to get better under the leadership of a madman. Never. Can't do anything but get worse, for sure. So Hosea Cleveland in the 3rd Congressional District. In the 4th Congressional District, there's a Republican that heads up that one, William Timmons. William Timmons' first term was in 2019. He won in 2018. That was his first term, just like Joe Cunningham. It's time to flip that seat, running against our Democratic candidate, Kim Nelson. Definitely qualified, definitely stand for all of the issues and the platform that I believe in and support, the Democratic platform, and definitely all of these people that I'm mentioning, trust me, I vetted them. They're not in here in this for glamour and glitz or to have their name up and I'm the senator or I'm the representative. None of that. These folks are ready to work for the people, period. I've seen Joe Cunningham working for the people, for sure. Is he perfect? Are any of these people perfect? No, they're not. But they're working for the people, and they will work for the people. Something that I cannot say about their opponents. Joe Wilson? No, don't work for the people. Jeff Duncan? No, don't work for the people. Nancy Mace ain't going to work for the people. So we need to get these folks out of there, for sure. District 5, another Republican is there. He's been there 3 years, okay? Won in 2016, sworn in 2017. He's been in 3 years. We need to make sure that he don't be in there another term, period. He's running against a young Democrat, Mo Brown. Mo Brown was a wide receiver with the Gamecocks, right, with Carolina. And not only that, he actually worked in Nikki Haley's cabinet for a while. He worked at the Department of Commerce under Nikki Haley. Where on his website, he says that he delivered more than 5,000 jobs and over $1 billion in economic development to rural towns. Young fellow, young brother, running against this Ralph Norman dude, who's a solid Republican who only votes the Republican way according to the Republican ticket. Gotta go. Gotta go. In the 6th Congressional District, we have a longstanding Democrat there. And the senior Democrat, the House Majority Whip, Jim Clyburn, Congressman Jim Clyburn. Clyburn was elected in 1993. He's been in office 27 years. And for this election, let me be perfectly clear, for this election, I'm riding with Clyburn because there's three other candidates, but there's a Republican running against him. One who yelled at the at our group down at the Battery, an expletive that I can't use, the other day or a couple of weeks ago down on the Battery. He drove past in a golf court cart and yelled out something that I can't say at the counter protesters to the Confederate battle flag people. So I'll take Jim Clyburn over this dude any day, or any of the other two people that's running. So in this dispensation of time, with these races right here, I'm definitely going with Jim Clyburn. After we flip that seat and go on to the next election, after we take the House and take the Senate and take the White House and take our state elections, y'all can ask me again about who I support, okay? After I see who's running. Bakari Sellers, you out there? You know where I'm going with that. Okay, so that's the 6th Congressional District. In the 7th Congressional District, Republican, Tom Rice, been there since 2013. He's a piece of work, another piece of work. Just like Jeff Duncan, just like Joe Wilson. It's a piece of work. We need to get rid of them. And he's running against a very good friend of mine, Melissa Watson. Melissa Watson is amazing, okay? I can't give her age out. I ain't getting ready to roll last time. It's not what I do when it comes to women. Uh-oh, I'm in trouble. I shared Kamala Harris's age, okay? But I'm not going to give Melissa's age out. She know how to put hand on me, okay? But she's a Dillon, South Carolina native who served in the Army from 95 until 2001. She holds an undergraduate degree from the College of Charleston, a graduate degree from the Citadel, and is a doctoral candidate at the University of Phoenix right now. She's a single mom with two beautiful children. And she understands the struggles that everyday families and businesses in districts 7 and the 7th District face. Why? Because she lives them. She spent her entire career focused on how to make her community a better place for everyone and dedicates her labor in the pursuit of education, working as a certified teacher. She was even chosen for the Rookie Teacher of the Year award at Baptist Hill High. She's a licensed realtor. She works as that when she's not leading the classroom. And whether you want to believe it or not, she works as a hostess in a restaurant, trying to make ends meet. Melissa spends much of her free time even volunteering for community organizations and as a leader in South Carolina politics. When it comes to understanding politics at all levels for this state, Melissa is phenomenal. I've known her for a while. She's someone that I would consider one of the most qualified people for this seat in our state. With all of that, teacher, realtor, waitress, all of this packaged up in this one woman, mom. Yeah, busy lady. Brains, that's right. All of that. She comes with my full endorsement. Although I'd endorse a donkey over Tom Rice any day. But Melissa is not the donkey. Melissa is a queen who deserves this seat. Because I know that she will do the best for the people of the 7th Congressional District and for the people of South Carolina. I firmly believe that in my heart. Firmly. I stand behind her 100%. So, on the reel tonight, that concludes the first installment of candidates, the federal candidates, the presidential candidates, Joe Biden and Kamala Harris. Because in my book, those are only two presidential candidates that are running. In Congress, in the Senate, Jamie Harrison. And again, the only one who we need to even consider. Lindsey Graham is not an option. No. He is expendable. Send him to the unemployment office. In the South Carolina House of Representatives, or United States House of Representatives, District 1, Joe Cunningham. District 2, Adair Ford Burroughs. District 3, Hosea Cleveland. District 4, Kim Nelson. District 5, Mo Brown. District 6, Jim Clyburn. And District 7, Melissa Watson. Let's go, folks. It's time to do this. It's time to change this thing around and make South Carolina not blue, but a place for everybody, where everybody has an opportunity to flourish, to grow, to thrive, and to experience the American dream. A place where life, liberty, and the pursuit of happiness is a reality, not where it's been taken away from for hundreds of years, from some people for hundreds of years. A place where the state motto, while I live, I breathe, while I breathe, I hope, where that motto becomes a reality for people who have forgotten how to hope. And you look across the state of South Carolina, I've seen the eyes of those who have no hope in their eyes in this state because of the policies and procedures that the Republicans have either implemented that were no good or failed to implement because they were good for the people. It's time to end that madness, folks. 2020 is the year. November 3rd is the election date. Get registered right now. Make sure that you do. Apply for your ballot right now, your mail-in ballot right now. Vote early. Get people registered. If you got people who are ex-offenders who are no longer on paper or off of parole and no longer have any more supervision fees or whatever, make sure they get registered and vote in this election. Even if you have child support delinquency, you can register and vote. Don't let nobody tell you any different. Or if you know people that are sitting in county jail and have not been to court and have not been convicted of anything, they can get registered and vote too. Please pass the word on. The more people we get to vote, the better this thing is going to be, because Donald Trump is going to try to steal this election. And then when he loses, it's my prediction, and I don't have a crystal ball or anything. Somebody called me, tried to say I was a psychic, but their vocabulary is not too extensive. They called me a physicist. I was like, wow, I got a compliment. They were really trying to say psychic, but I don't have a crystal ball. But I do believe, honestly, and I'm going to tell you this, I believe this honestly, that Donald Trump is not going to leave the White House willingly. They're going to have to drag him out of there, and his people out in the streets are going to cause trouble. So we need to make sure that when he loses on November 3rd, it's by so great of a margin. Remember, Hillary Clinton, she won by, I think, a few million votes, and still they took the election. So we need to defeat this fool by about 20, 30, 40,000 votes. I mean, excuse me, 40, or whatever. We need to outvote him thoroughly and put him out so that the Electoral College knows that they can't cheat. So with that being said, I'm going to get some rest. I'm a little weary tonight. It's been a long day. And I got another Facebook Live tomorrow where we're going to talk about South Carolina State House, the General Assembly elections, okay? So, to everybody on here, please, no matter which way it goes tonight, make sure you hug your kids. Tell them, whisper in their ear if they're asleep already. Whisper that you love them. Give them a hug. Give them a kiss, okay? Tell your baby mama or baby daddy or significant other, whomever it might be. Tell them you love them tonight. And even tell those people who you don't really vibe with anymore, give them a call. Send them a text. Tell them you love them. And for everybody on here, I just want to leave you with this, okay? No matter who you are, no matter where you are, no matter whether our time together has been good or difficult, I love you. I want you to understand that. I love you. And there's absolutely nothing that you can do about that. Absolutely. I'm going to love you no matter what. Y'all take care. Have a wonderful evening. And if you can, join me again tomorrow night, 8:30 p.m., Facebook Live with the Pastor. Peace.